Hello guys, everyone, welcome. So today, this is the third session which we will discuss some stuff on design architecture, social life, so on and so forth.
Okay. Session which we will discuss some stuff on design architecture, social life.
There is a background. Okay, now there was an echo. We don't have anymore. First, I want to start with the discussion, usual discussion that I share some posts on social media, and then some people are actually wondering what they mean, and can you explain, Orhan, while you were sharing this, what exactly you mean? And usually I use Twitter and LinkedIn for this, as you might know. You are probably following already on the social media my accounts. So Twitter Orhan Ergün CCD and LinkedIn Orhan Ergün. And many people also commenting under those posts. I think on Twitter we are calling it tweet. And today let's discuss two of them. Again, architectural related stuff. Meanwhile, if you have any comments, any questions, we will talk about those as well. If I finish the part which I want to talk quickly, so I will also answer any of your questions. You can ask any question in the networking domain, technical questions you can ask. And I mean, starting from there to design to the anything on the, I don't know, segment routing, beer, Rift, BGP, SPF, etc. So you can we can discuss those stuff. But let's start now. This first tweet or LinkedIn share also I shared on both of those channels, because probably the followers from different, usually different places. I've seen most US people on Twitter and the rest of the European and the other people on LinkedIn more. So I want hopefully everybody to get benefits from these sharings and videos, lots of stuff, as you know, we are producing, and hopefully they are getting benefits from all. The first one was actually between them, there was only an hour, maybe less. I said, don't try to solve problems until you are sure they are problems you actually have. Actually, I am seeing this one again and again. As you might know, we are running a training and consultancy company, and one of my job is also consultancy, and most of the consultancy customers coming from the student space, their companies, etc. I remember one day one guy came and asked, Orhan, we have four data centers and they are connecting them through layer 2 VPLS. So VPLS is MPLS based layer 2 VPN, basically multi-point VPN, we call it. So virtual private LAN service, IETF term. If you are coming from the Metro Ethernet forum background, so it's called ELAN service, not LINE, LAN service. And then, okay, sure, someone probably would say, by the way, we have VPLS, and then we want to basically migrate to BGP, we have OSPF today. As a consultant, what you want to do, if you will take this one as a constraint, so pre-made decision, then you will continue. But the guy was also my student. I wanted to show him that we should always do the design for the problems. I mean, there should be some benefits. What the company thinks about this? Well, how did you come to this decision? I want to analyze. By the way, analyzing mean, we will touch this one again. Analyzing mean, understand the consequence of the decisions you made. Okay. I asked, okay, what's the reason why you want to migrate from OSPF to BGP? And he said, actually, there are many reasons, Orhan. So scalability was one. Sure. You said four data center, how many prefixes you will carry? So you want to migrate from OSPF to BGP? He said, actually, we will not. So we are running Anycast service. Okay. What else then your requirement, you think? As you know, Orhan, BGP is multi-protocol. So we are carrying 20 different address family. So 18 plus, so probably today more than 20 different address family. So that's why not only IPv4 unicast, later on when we want to have V6 or VPME for VPME 6, not unicast, maybe multicast and so on and so forth, we can do this, right? Yes, but you don't want to design after 5 years what you will have, 10 years what you will have. Also, if you want those services, there are always alternatives as well. If you want to do multicast, I mean, just for the customer signaling, let's say, other than BGP, we have many other things, or for the transport, other than BGP, many things as well. Okay, what else? I'm trying to find the actual requirements that would lead us, actually, as a problem, something that would lead us to this, to do this migration. And if he would say something, probably, I don't remember, maybe traffic engineering also, he said, then, okay, are you doing today anything about it? By the way, anycast mean, anycast, not a protocol. Anycast is way of assigning IP address. So same IP address, same subnet mask length from multiple different places you assign. By the way, I saw somewhere, I think Cisco presentation was, people are making so much term, and we are very good at that, I think, especially network engineers. So I remember redundant anycast, something like that. Basically what they were doing, two different places, /32 one from one side, /31 from another side, and they were calling this redundant anycast. So like, what was that? Multi-node HSRP, anycast HSRP, right? So it reminded me that, but anyway, there is no backup for the anycast. Anycast is way of assigning IP address, same IP, exactly same subnet mask, otherwise longest match will win. And those way of assigning IP, by the way, /32 from one side, /31 from another side, or etc., or /30 from one side, /29 from another side, we call it phantom assignment. So phantom RP, for example, in Pinbinder, you can use this way. So people are making so much turn, just let's not fall into that trap. Okay, I was talking about that guy's requirement. Actually, there was no requirement. There was no problem in the first place. And yeah, we couldn't continue. They didn't do this migration. But of course, you might have lots of this kind of stories. I mean, you can find the guy maybe coming to you, your boss, and telling you, let's change this. Do you think it would be beneficial? I mean, you maybe will say no, but they are looking to change something. And maybe without changing, just tuning some things, some timers, some values, some services, maybe you will add, by using what exactly you have today, you can have better network design. So it's not all about changing, guys, with the totally new technology. It's very risky. Anyway, but let's also talk about another tweet first. Then we can deep dive maybe some of these topics and so on and so forth. Another one was a little bit more, actually, more people commented on this one, especially on LinkedIn, I see. And I want to talk also about the comments of the people. So if you want to comment, you can do it now also. You should be able to. Tip of the day, by the way, I said, you should be able to justify your network design decisions. This is a very important point. Now we will talk a little bit about this one, why you would want to do that, and where are the places, this is important, why you would want to justify. You should be able to explain why you made them, those decisions, and why you rejected the alternatives, and based on measurable facts. In fact, every word here needs to be explained. And there are many things here, years of knowledge, to be honest, to understand and then talk in detail, and lots of examples, right? Lots of examples can be given. What Einstein says, example is not another way of teaching, it's the only way of teaching, actually. Examples are important to talk. Let's start. What we are saying, you should be able to justify your design decisions. By the way, one of the interesting comment on that was someone, James says, I don't know James, but I know Melchior. Melchior basically redirecting James there. You might, he says, Melchior is the routing security person, we can say. I made also a video on this YouTube channel with Melchior. We discussed BGP routing security, specifically PET validation mechanism. There is one, actually he wrote the draft also, he's the founder of that. One PET validation, there was a couple probably other authors as well. Mechanism in the BGP security space, let's say, information security space, and the draft he wrote basically called ASCONS, and there are a couple other alternatives. Today there is one anyway, already published RFC for the BGP security. It's called BGPSEC. The protocol name is BGPSEC. It's not just abbreviation of the BGP security. Protocol name is BGPSEC. And another approach is for the PET validation, ASPA, Autonomous System Provider Authorization. And the totally different approach, actually, totally opposite of what ASPA is suggesting, is Melchior is suggesting. And both are solving the issue, but from different aspects. Again, totally excellent design example, actually, those two approaches. One is looking from the customer side, another looking from the provider side, transit AS side, the problem. So there is no winner. There is no winner. And please, whoever is watching this, after today, do this way. I've seen a lot of people are sharing, I am the best, who is the next, blah, blah, blah. Or this protocol is the best, who is the next? So there is no best. Let's first understand this. Even sometimes for my trainings, I am saying I am the best. Okay, you can say, and it shows that you are following also my YouTube channel, or how you are saying best. There is no best. There is only context, and there is no good. There is no bad. There is no ever. There is no never. There is no always. Okay, those words, designer has to just stay away. Because always context, without talking, from which aspect you are best, ask this, or protocol, this protocol you think is the best, this technology is the best. You should definitely talk in this way. Ask them, okay, trainer is saying, the best training you will see. Let's give an example from this, because you will see this one a lot. Not in the networking, maybe you are getting the training from other people, from other domains. So from many aspects, probably today you are comparing it, right? Not only the guy, maybe most knowledgeable person among the other trainers. You are maybe looking also cost of the training, how much it is. So same thing I will learn. If every other aspect is the same, cost might be another consideration point. So not only cost, the knowledgeable that person or not, what are the elements of that training. Let's say, let's give an example from CCIE. So as we know, for the enterprise exam now we have a design topic as well as lab. So the guy, if he's saying someone, I am the best, you should ask him from design aspect, really from that point, are you the best? Or from the lab point of view, who told you you are the best, by the way? In from which aspect? What was the measurable fact? Many people pass the exam, or many people talk about me. So there is no best. You cannot come to that conclusion without telling some measurable fact. You cannot say best protocol based on what? Or simplest network design, or most complex design. From which aspect? Do you have numerical number? Can you give? This network is 50% complex, 20% complex. Or basically, this trainer is 90% best. So anyway, this is one thing. Why I said that, I will come there. Okay, you should be able to justify your design decision. Let's talk about this one. It's very important. Let's say someone is asking which protocol is best. Of course, if someone asks in this way, immediately your answer depends. But for me to talk about those dependencies, I need to know what these guys are looking for. For this one, by the way, let's first understand why in the first place I would like to justify. because some people in your companies maybe also they refuse, right? So back in old days, to be honest, I was like that. So if I am telling this, especially while I was working with the company, so if you are becoming rock star after some time, yeah, this guy is then from network point of view, we should go to this guy. Maybe most of you are like this. And because of familiarity, so you know that network, if you are working for a long time very well, in and out, so people will come to you. And maybe you are really good, that's also another case. But after some time, maybe you are saying, I don't need to justify. Okay. So because, yes, maybe your real decisions, out of 10 decisions, 9 of them always correct. Maybe out of 100, 95 of them correct. No problem. Maybe all of them correct. Right? So you shouldn't. You proved yourself. Why you should justify? You can think in this way. And we are doing this, guys, in our network career. We are doing this. And what is wrong with this is actually this, couple things. First, let's understand what is analyzing. Analyze the networking, analyzing network design. So analyzing, as I told you in the beginning, is understanding the design decisions and their consequences. Why you did in this way? Why you selected BGP? That guy selected BGP, and if he is not documenting it, if he is not telling the reasons after he leaves that company and new designer came, he may not understand. Maybe not BGP only, but you got the point. There might be many decisions, and some of them based on that guy's experience. Some of them maybe company told something those days, but things change. Guys, networks change. Any successful system change. Because when the business is successful, network grows, business grows, and you need to adapt to these changes. In design, we have a couple different type of changes. If it's a successful change, so growth, we call it organic or inorganic growth, and different design decisions we take for each cases, and so on and so forth. But in the first place, these decisions and documenting them will help for the future people, maybe when you replace or new hire people. So when they see this one, so they will understand if there is corner cases or did you follow the any known design pattern and so on and so forth. Okay, why we did this design decisions now? Probably we understand. Justify it. Justification. Why I did this? There was multiple functional requirements, and then I don't want to say non-functional requirements, but some attributes which make the design more quality attributes, and then some constraints. So company told me this way, they decided this, so they have to use this provider because this provider is basically they made 20 years agreement, so some pre-made decisions, you cannot change this stuff. Okay, based on those facts, based on those reasons, I made this decision. I cannot come and tell, okay, I am the most knowledgeable person, that's why I did. Yes, for sure, you might be. But in different network, you will do different decisions. Okay? Totally different decisions. Same vendor, same protocols, everything can be same, different decisions you might give. Okay. You should be able to explain why you made them and why you rejected the alternatives. So there will be always alternative. There is no single protocol which comes always with the benefit. There is no also protocol which always comes with the problem. So there is no, for example, from the routing protocol, if you are coming from the routing background, there is no best. If you are, for example, choosing the different physical network architectures, I don't know, like from the layering point of view, you can start like 2-tier, 3-tier, there is no best. Depends on what is the scalability requirement, for example, and what is the availability requirement, for example. Do you have the circuits or do you want to manage more devices? So these are all just decision for 2-tier, 3-tier. But then you might be, talking about many technologies, and you will always do this trade-off and comparison between the different technologies protocol, guys. So there is no single best thing. And we have all these alternative. IBGP network, route reflector is best because many people are doing. No, because many people, many networks, it fits, but there will be always cases that confederation might be better. Okay, for example, in the merger and acquisition scenarios, it gives a lot of benefits. You might continue with the confederation in that case. Or if, especially if there are not much exit points and not much also devices in the network, you might want to do full mesh IBGP, because otherwise route reflector will choose only one best path. And these are, if I go in this way, it will be very technical for general audience. So I am trying to tell there will be always some alternative protocols. And just because we know, it's not enough. Why we did these decisions and what are the measurable facts? And that last part, measurable facts. Okay, people will tell you, we are looking for the robust design, or it shouldn't be fragile. There is already motto in the design, robust yet fragile. So if you are trying to make something robust, probably from some other aspects, you are making it fragile, right? So if you are trying to put more security into your system, you are trying to make it more secure, probably user experience and performance will be reduced, right? So, or if you are trying to something converge fast for better availability, maybe that converging fast you probably will affect your stability of your network. And always these trade-offs are there. Knowing these trade-offs and deciding your design based on those trade-offs make you designer. Okay. And that's the point. And those two topics which I want to discuss today. There is there a question? Let me see about no. So let's discuss about something on the design architecture point of view. Though I am seeing it's already some fast reroute and MPLS, those kind of questions. Should we do this way or? Maybe end up this video and then maybe next video is a technical one. So I'm not sure yet. So did you understand my point so far? That is important. So did you get the point? We are not anymore telling or not immediately believing if someone says this one is better than others. Okay, what is the context? From which aspect you are talking about? You will answer, you will ask this question to them. Or better, best, worst, always, ever. So don't believe those people. They can be just, I mean, they might be doing intentionally this or unintentionally. Vendors might be doing intentionally because their job is to sell their product. Any vendor, I'm not distinguishing. But other people, not maybe vendor people, they might be doing this because just it is marketing. I mean, everybody is doing marketing themselves. If I am talking at the moment here like this, I am marketing myself, right? So I am showing maybe how knowledgeable I am or whatever I wanted to show you. So this is marketing, guys. And this is all about marketing. But ask them, ask this question, why you are saying best? From which aspect you are talking about? Can you prove this? Okay. These are the questions we will ask. What is this? Could you very fast, let me go through those questions maybe, but if these are very specific, we may not be serving to everyone, because I think these videos are just, especially this network design architecture videos are watched by many people. I seen the first video last week already, almost 1,000 people watched that. And if you want me to just open these sessions and then live talk about the stuff and then get the questions of the participants, like the video. Please like the video, because how I can understand whether you want it or not. So please like the video and comment maybe below the videos. You can ask your technical questions just below the videos and we can continue. Ah, by the way, what I told you, I will talk about the comments for this. Let's talk about this. You should be able to justify your network design decisions. Okay, let's talk about some comments for that post. Man here says, you might want to talk to James. Okay, actually, that I know, I don't know James, but he sent me actually, yeah, this reply. He says, Orhan, this is the talk I gave on design earlier this year, UK NOF, Network Operator Forum Days at UK. I opened the video, I couldn't watch yet, but he says, what? Keeps your eyes open for a podcast episode coming soon. Okay, probably after I watch the video, we can make maybe video with James as well. And in the podcast, I mentioned that as a designer, the ideal scenario for me is that I actually make no decisions. And you always have to have decisions anyway, because expectation from architects and designers, by the way, I made this distinction between architect and designer in the first video, network design and architect, architecture talk, or an Orhan Ergün video one or in YouTube channel. You can please have a look at from that guy, guys. And then you need to make decisions. And but those decisions, early decisions you need to make. You cannot make every decisions just from the day one. And it will evolve with the networks also when network changes. We have narrow the business requirements down. Sure, very good. What our vendors can provide. I think here you are saying, I read this comment and then what I understand, you are not talking about the greenfield design. Anyway, you are talking about brownfield, but also not purchasing new equipment, but whatever your devices, existing devices, can offer you from the capability point of view, future capability, etc., speed and fit. What our ops guys can support, excellent, because at the end, you are doing the design, take the requirements, constraints, functional, non-functional, all those stuff from the business and translating to actual technical specification, and ops guys will follow that. And even the design decisions should be, of course, one of the design attributes, quality attributes should be what? Maintainability, which means what? Those ops guys will maintain, will operate your network. So let's say you want to migrate, just classical example, OSPF to ISAS. Do they know ISAS? How long it will take for them to learn ISAS? What will be the learning curve? Budget, do you have enough time? Can you give them for when there is a problem? So many questions, you see. Good, excellent. To the single most optimal choice, I mean, there may not be always a single choice. There might be a couple, maybe. Decision, and then of course you need to talk with the stakeholders again and again, and iterative process, and you will come up with the most optimal choice. Excellent, actually, guys. Comment is very good. One thing I have started doing recently is documenting why we choose not to do something. Okay, good. Actually, they are documenting as well. When this guy is doing this, to be honest, he might leave the company, and he's doing a favor for his company actually. Because when new guy comes, he may not know. I mean, this handover job might be months. But of course, good documentation is not huge documentation. Important points, priority is important. We will, with this design talks, we will talk about how to do the stakeholder discussions, how to prioritize those basically feedbacks. The requirements when we gather from the stakeholders, how we will prioritize them. Do we prioritize as a designer or stakeholders? We will talk those stuff. One thing I haven't, so basically they are documenting not why not also they didn't choose. Okay, so why they rejected the alternatives. It might be fun to talk with James, because it seems he had already YouTube video for that, and then we can discuss, of course, while he's doing something, I will ask why we did this, why you did didn't do this. Alternatives, it might be a little bit technical discussion. I need to watch the video if he was technical. So let's see. Another one, yeah, Adam Morton says, because we have always done it this way is not an acceptable reason for a decision. In the very beginning, I said, yeah, after sometimes, especially when you become like rock star in your company, you might be doing in this way, right? So I know this stuff, so I don't have to explain. Yeah, we are doing this. Probably many of you might be doing this. This is for yourself. You might forget some stuff. I write many articles. In fact, my articles and my books is for myself, because after some time, it's just too much that I forget. I forget. Guys, especially when it comes to technology, individual technology, so we call it breadth and depth, right? So I learn a lot of things about specific technology, particular technology, so much bit byte level, not configuration, but especially what route types and all those stuff about any technology. Then after some time, you will forget because you are doing other things. You are interested with the other protocols, other technologies, and architectural decisions, and so on and so forth. Just you can. Some things you will forget. And then that's why I write them down in blog posts, in books, and most of the time I am talking with the students. Sometimes also you see the public YouTube videos as well. So writing them down and also probably not saying, okay, tell please, maybe you can tell to your colleagues that I don't need to explain to you guys. But still, you may want to write them down for yourself as well as for the future, maybe, architects, okay? I agree with that, Adam, actually. But there was one comment for this one, I think. Someone just made, I think, lady. Let me check that one because I don't agree with that. Let's also talk, but I think maybe she deleted that. Not sure. Give me a second. Yeah, I think so. I think so. Also, another guy saying it's not voodoo when you make a network decision, so it's not a magic. So, of course, not a magic. We know what we do. When I say this, we know what we do many times, let's say, we know what we do, not always. I mean, because design is complex stuff and design is managing the interaction between the different things like protocols, IGP, BGP, MPLS, all of them at the same time running in the networks, right? And managing those complexities. Probably, what's happening, I'm not probably, I mean, any design, not only network design, emerging behavior. So something happens, you may not actually estimate definitely what will happen. Okay, emerging behavior is called. And yeah, that's the truth. Details versus broad knowledge, Alessio says, definitely. So in some places I said, I think one first or second design architecture discussion, Alessio, I was talking about this. If you want to be a designer and architect, you need to make decision also about, will I know the details of the protocols and maybe configuration point of view as well, how to configure on Cisco, how to configure on Juniper, et cetera, as well, or will I continue being a designer or architect, which means a high-level overview, but many technologies, so breadth and depth, we are calling it. You cannot have, unfortunately, our brains are limited. You cannot learn everything. You cannot, even from this technology point of view, there are just a lot. So from multiple of them, especially in interrelated with your area. So, I mean, network, we are network engineers. We should understand, of course, from cloud as well. We should understand from little bit at least from the virtualization, containerization, from security as well. So you don't have to be an expert for each and every of those domains. You need to even understand from storage. You need to understand from many other places, high level, for you to decide architecture, network architecture. Okay, but when you decide something, let's say cloud, okay, we will do, I don't know, public cloud, then you may not be expert on everything, of course. You in your company, there might be other specialized guys who is very good on those bit by level detail configuration, etc. They might be doing that. Okay, same thing for the service provider networks, think about them. So there are multiple parts. So architect might decide end-to-end design. Usually I seen as strategy team architecture or strategy team, I see in the service providers like this. And then they are deciding end-to-end, even if it's mobile services, fixed broadband, mobile broadband at the same time. So there are a couple guys basically responsible from the entire architecture. Then individual domain experts are there, like, I am the RAN expert. I am backbone engineer. I am basically expert on the internet gateways, and I am responsible from those. So this is classical depth and breadth discussion, guys. Okay. So yeah, what is this? 100% with you, except for the brain limit. Coffee with Lau will let us perform better. By the way, there is a story behind that. Alessio is my also CCD student. As you might know, I am doing CCDE training. I have been doing for, I think, 7 years now. And many years ago, we were together in Istanbul on-site CCD class. So he's one of the designer guy. He has a broad knowledge, I should say. So, when I first time met with him, he was insisting as well, I should say, insisting. So like, okay, this is the truth. There is no truth. Maybe after many years, maybe I am convincing him now. There is no single truth. There is no good, bad, many times I said in this video, from which aspect we are talking about. Even from that aspect, just one level of detail, so context, may not be enough to come to conclusion. Maybe a couple level of context we need to talk. If this happens, and if this happens as well, subcontext, then this best design decision is this one, etc. Okay, and yeah, I think if there is no other comments. No. Actually, I remember one. Now I don't see that comment, but I remember that comment. So let me talk about that. Very important. So someone said, design is an art. Interesting, right? So by the way, it looks like nice thing. Yeah, design is an art. I am like an artist then. Yeah, very nice. So I am artist or an artist. No, actually opposite. Design cannot be an art, shouldn't be an art. Design is engineering, which means art is unique thing. Okay? And I cannot even paint well. So art is a unique thing, but in design, we don't expect uniqueness. We follow design patterns. So when I get the requirements, immediately I start thinking, okay, should I do layered design or should I do scale up, scale out? Should I do closed design, fat tree here? Should I choose which? So there is always requirement and measurable facts. So there is no unique design here. I am just following the patterns. So already tried, tested, working solutions, architectures. So just maybe I know many of them, top of my heart, and immediately I'm coming to the maybe conclusions faster than some other people, but it is not an art. Art is unique thing, okay? And we have to avoid uniqueness in network design. Another thing, design is a science, engineering, exactly, because we are coming with the something so everybody agreed on. What does it mean? But of course, I'm talking about the requirements. If requirements are clear, I'm not talking customer will give clear requirements. How we get them, we make them clear. We will talk about those, how we can get the clear requirements, etc. Constraints are there, requirements are there, everything are given. Then all of us, if we are talking, if we are designer, all of us, we should come to the same conclusion, same design decisions. There might be minor details as well. Like, okay, based on the requirements, we need to choose IPsec. We need to all have to come to the IPsec, let's say. But maybe you are doing with the crypto map. I am doing maybe with the IPsec profile. So, but both of us need to come with the point-to-point IPsec. Based on those requirements, another requirements might lead us to do a GetVPN. Okay? But we need to understand those. And then based on those things, we will come up definitely on the same decision. There might be always minor implementation details. So I didn't discuss today about those MPLS, etc. I see questions. Arnie is asking, could you discuss situation when RSVP, DTUR, LSP not signaled within the same OSPF area, M2 signaling, etc. So we discussed this. Probably you were there as well. We discussed in the previous video about the fast reroute, okay, and the fast rehashing. In the just previous video, it was even not much technical detail because high level, we just talk, okay, this is the LFA, it cannot protect 100% of the topologies. If you are looking for the 100% topology coverage, etc., I need this is for you. TILFA or RSVP-based FRR you need to get, and post-optimal convergence, but only TILFA can give. I did a little bit explained about the different type of backups, so one-to-one backup, facility backup, etc. So D2 LSP is the that facility backup. So, but if I talk now details of that, probably I will lose many packets. I mean, many people will just leave the session. So this one is not very deep level technical, as you can see, video. Just I am talking high level design and architecture stuff. But for sure, there will be place for the deep technical questions as well. Like, I think video 2 was like that. Okay, can you please talk about the impact of distributed protocol state growth network node in the control and data plane? Someone asked about that. So distributed protocol state growth. So I think you are talking about the central versus distributed architecture. And here, if the question is this, by the way, but that's why I'm saying you need to first understand the, do you have a problem or not in the first place? In the beginning of the video, we talked about that. What is the problem? So at the moment, I didn't probably 100%, I didn't understand your question. That's why now if I start giving the answer, maybe I will give the answer, so which means the solution to wrong problem. Can you make it a little bit more clear so then I can give you a design trade-off there for the centralized versus distributed architecture if you want. We can just talk high level. And then another question. By the way, it's almost like 45 minutes. I will finish up this video. If you have questions, please go ahead. And very fast. Meanwhile, I am checking if there is... On Twitter, usually people don't reply. They like it. They retweet it, but they don't reply. So. I didn't get the Darren actually commented on which one, on which tweet actually, this one. Yeah, this tip of the day, you should be able to justify your network design decisions. Reasoning, so knowing the design decision, the reason about that, and ability to listen to all sides of the story. I think he's talking about talking with the many stakeholders. So you need to talk about the business, you need to talk about the operation people as well, not just one side. I think he's talking about that. And compromise are key attributes. So compromise mean, okay, you cannot come up with the perfect design. So in the last video, I explained that why not perfect design is not there. So people, if you talk with the many stakeholders, you might end up with the hundreds of requirements. Hundreds of requirements. And you cannot just make all of them, guys. There is nothing like that, okay? If someone is asking from you security, I mean, excellent security and excellent performance, there is nothing like that, okay? So you need to compromise. So you need to understand the trade-offs. If you do one thing, it will affect other things. So usually it's called butterfly effect in design. So if you change something, how it will affect other things. So same thing for the trade-offs as well. You shouldn't forget this. If I want to change let's say for availability, for the availability, there are a couple tactics. What you can do for the availability, extra redundancy, right? So those extra redundancy makes more complex your network. So there is no free lunch. So always compromise. Do you think SRv6 is going to be the next thing to learn? Excellent question. And we discussed actually this one also in the YouTube channel. Exactly, question was this. Should we invest on, I mean, SRv6? My answer, and also I discussed this one with Jeff Tansura, and both of our answers, at the moment, not. But in the future, who knows? There are some things that need to be enhanced, and have a look at that video, Dipankar. I think short video, less than 10 minutes, 8 minutes video. Have a look at that one. So you might get extra knowledge from that. Can you please give some idea about central versus distributed control and data plane? Sure, very fast. Let's do that one as well. So always there are a couple trade-offs there as well, like any other things. So when you do centralization, usually the traffic engineering might give you better global coverage, better global path optimization, what we say. So if you are looking for the most optimal routing, especially inter-area, inter-AS networks, a centralization will give you a better view. Because of that better view, you can basically come up with the usually I am saying, because even with the distributed architecture, though a little bit more complex anyway, but you can still come up with the optimal routing, like loose hop extension in MPLS traffic engineering. But same idea, even back in old days, so there was distributed versus centralized traffic engineering. So PCE has been around for decades. And also distributed way of doing the optimal routing also has been around decades. Loose hop extension, for example, right? Some people might know these terms. So, or if you don't know, take a note and you can have a look at. But as I told you, normally this video wouldn't be so deep technical details. Let me finish. So PCE, path computation element, can give you better, basically, optimal routing. Optimality criteria. What is optimal routing? This one requires another 1 hour, maybe, just discussion. Every of my words requires so much, guys, deep level discussions, explaining. That's why in the morning, in the afternoon, I am just tweeting something or sharing on LinkedIn, maybe one sentence. Then, as you can see, in the evening, 1 hour maybe, explanation, and then from many aspects, basically giving lots of examples. Hopefully it is fun. For me, it is fun. But anyway. So traffic engineering is one thing. Very fast, let me answer. Maybe other questions are there as well. But on the other side, for example, you are making another trade-off, like fast conversions. So distributed architecture can give you fast conversions, faster conversions, fast reroute also option. But centralized architecture will not be as fast as distributed architecture. But there are many other trade-offs there to make it. TE versus convergence. So more optimal routing versus availability, I mean convergence, is one thing that is you are doing usually. On the other side, of course, state you are carrying now to the controller, or maybe you are not, maybe some state still in the network, some state in the controller. What we are seeing, actually, state in the network, but as well as on the controller as well. Why you do that? Again, for the maybe inter-area, inter-AS traffic engineering, but also there is another reason. For example, RSVP, those who know RSVP and SR on a distributed architecture, OSPF and SAS, those protocols can use CSPF protocol, constraint-based SPF. But when you use the controller, it might be more attribute, more intelligent algorithms than CSPF you can run on the controller, right? So not only bandwidth, not only link coloring, etc., those attributes that CSPF take into account, but many other things maybe you can put into the logic of the controller's constraints, let's say. So, what else? Spine and leaf architecture. I think that one I need to answer now. Spine and leaf architecture versus core and access architecture. Core and access. So people usually call it traditional, okay? And also have a look at the last video. We discussed this a little bit, but let me answer. If you have specific, since the beginning, I have been trying to just saying this. Guys, if you ask very high level like that, I need to talk hours and hours. But if you say something specific in the context from this point of view, Orhan, what we should do, then my answer will be shorter. And probably I can say, do it in this way, this is the best. Okay, otherwise you cannot get that best answer from me. And also my talking time will be reduced a lot if you ask just in the individual context. Otherwise, so much I need to talk. I like to talk also, but who will watch after that 2-3 hours video? That's the problem. Can you justify the complexity of spine and leaf? Of course I can. So this is another trade-off, especially spine leaf architecture. We call it equidistance architectures, right? So in case of axis distribution core or axis collapse distribution cores, what you are doing, so those distributions are connected to each other. And so you are in the first place, you are just breaking that equidistance idea. So and also scale up versus scale out. Idea. So spine and leaf in the first place you are doing for scalability, and by doing the scale out design you are doing this. So 3-stage, 5-stage closed topologies. So not only leaf and spine, leaf spine, super spine, or top of rack leaf spine, spine, super spine. So how many layers basically will tell us the scalability needs. And here, if you are looking for the predictable latency, and also if you are looking to get a high amount of bandwidth between the devices, especially in the wherever you are deploying that, and today most commonplace data center, but I have seen leaf and spine in the internet gateway layers of the service provider, national service provider as well, though much smaller scope, of course, number of leaf layer switches and number of spine point of view, but anyway, that architecture, because the predictable latency it gives, and especially in the IGW layer in the service provider, they connect the CDN nodes, cache engines, etc. So you may want to look at from this latency aspect point of view. So there are many reasons actually why you are doing leaf and spine. So this being a equidistant, so giving the predictable latency versus giving high amount of maybe capacity. Also, what else? So in terms of failure, for example, in the classical access distribution, when you put two distribution switches, if one uplink goes down, 50% of the people will be affected. In the leaf and spine, if you are connecting leaf to the, let's say, 8 spine, and if one link goes down now, what? 12% of the traffic will go down. So that's the point that you are doing the scale out, and that's the point you are doing this leaf and spine architecture. So when there is a failure, we call it in the design blast reduce. So what will be the effect of that failure? Blast reduce will be what? Is it too much? No, because you are connecting those leaf spine layers via multiple interfaces, which we call also fan out ratio. There are many terminologies. As I told you, normally I wouldn't do this with the. Unfortunately, always I start just I will talk about something, maybe half an hour, then almost now 1 hour. Okay, continue. What else? Any other question do you have? Meanwhile, let me check if there is any other comment for the post which I want to talk today, which is this. I don't know, but if I share something that funny, that I like and I find is funny, many people like it. Like one post, this Leonardo DiCaprio, 2,000 people. 2,000 people like it so far. This tip of the day, you should be able to justify your network design decisions. Maybe after this, watching this video, people may like it. I don't know. But so far, 72 people only like this. No, this should be at least 500. But more than 5,000 people seen this anyway. It shows that they are not interested, or shows that they don't understand, or I don't know what it shows. What do you think? Why they don't like much? That's a good answer. I will ask more specific next time, sure. And if the questions are are finished. Let's end the session, guys. But again, if I would repeat that point, when you see someone, especially instructors are doing this too much, I am the best. I'm just loving this, and you should also. From which aspect you are the best? Ask this. Huh? Are you the cheapest? Are you the most knowledgeable person? Are your, I don't know, materials are the best? Are your explanation is the best? From which aspect you are the best? What makes you best? And okay, can you give the number? How much you are better than that guy? Someone, so should be baseline. And by the way, for you to say that you are best, you need to know the others as well. So for me to tell you OSPF is best and better than EIGRP and BGP, I need to know EIGRP and BGP as well. Do you know your competitors? Did you compete with them? By the way, from technical aspect, I am open to compete with anyone. Okay, so by saying this, and I think everyone should be open, and they should defend their decisions. They are teaching design, and they are knowing these technologies, right? Everyone knows. If you are saying best, everyone will say best, because everyone can be best from some aspect. Network technologies are not different than this. Okay, so RIP version 2. I mean, it can be best from some aspect and better than other protocols. Okay, there are just, when I say this, hundreds of technologies are coming into my mind, and I want to give example, but just makes this video more technical. And anyway, just, I don't know. Some people might be watching this video from outside of networking domain, and let's keep this one still understandable and fun. But already I talked a little bit about MPLS traffic engineering, etc. Could you explain the potential of white boxes in service provider environment, especially in the NFV and these 5G networks? We are seeing this one in the real life networks, but there is always also pros and cons of this white box versus non-vendors out there, you know, supports-wise, software, hardware, lots of interactions are there. And managing, what type of businesses in the first place we are talking about? So, Luis, another huge discussions probably deserves one separate sessions. Okay, guys, last 2 minutes, almost 1 hour. We have, if there is any comment on the post which I want to talk. Okay, actually James just post about that. I don't have time right now, but I would love to discuss more with you. Sure, actually, because I asked, that's why, if you have time now, just let's do it, the discussion now. But probably I can talk with him, and he can present his design, and we can talk maybe live, maybe we can record and then share on my YouTube channel. Depends on the guest, of course. I'm okay with the live, but not everyone might be okay. Let's see. Very good. In my experience, writing documentation and why I make choices also helps me see any flaws, help you in the first place. And also, if you leave that company, or if something happens to you, or maybe company is growing and new architects comes, it will help them as well, documentation for that. Of course, as a network engineers, we love documentation, right? But you don't have to document. There are tools for help, also especially from the assurance point of view might be helping, but from the architecture preparation of your network architecture, there are tools as well. Maybe in one session we can talk about those tools as well. Guys, if you like this video, really like the video, so hit the like button. Also comment under this video and share these stories. Orhan is doing this, go and subscribe to his channel, so because we can continue doing these live sessions, and then not only answering your questions, but hopefully you are learning some stuff from these discussions. Okay, it's an hour already, and let's finish the video. There was no presentation, but I talked too much maybe. Though I didn't answer many of your maybe questions, still I answered some of your questions, trying to keep it at the high level, not very deep level technical this time. And see you on the next time.